Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. In the earlier session, we have had an overview of chapter 2 related to public finance and what are the major functions of a government and what is the need, first of all, for the government to intervene into the markets. And of course, the major reason being the market failure. In other words, if left to the market, the free market economy will lead to a lot of problems. The basic demand supply mechanism works well, but not always. There are exceptions to the smooth functioning of a market economy, and because of those exceptions and because of those grave situations, definitely government intervention is required. Today, let us focus on the reasons for market failure in Unit 2 of Chapter 2, which focuses on the background of government intervention. How the government will actually take actions related to each of these problems, that we will see in next unit, that is unit 3. But before going to that, we should understand why markets fail, first of all. Okay, according to many classical economists and neoclassical economists, including Alfred Marshall and Adam Smith, market economy is a very sophisticated structure of economic systems, and it is self-correcting. It works very well with the price mechanism, and that price mechanism works with the demand and supply of various goods and services. See, normally it works well. Nobody is saying that markets keep on failing every time, but the problem is they cannot be left unattended, they cannot be left uncontrolled by the government. If it happens, then naturally the market failure becomes more problematic, and the reasons for such market failure are many. That's what we are going to discuss in this particular unit 2 of chapter 2. Of course, what are the reasons for market failure at a broader level? There are four major reasons for market failure. One is market power. Second one is externalities. Third one is public goods. Rather, we can say the lack of provision of public goods by the market, or the failure of market to provide public goods, and incomplete information that prevails in a market. These are the major four reasons for market failure. And in this unit, we have to deep dive into each of these reasons and what causes will create a situation of market failure in each of these scenarios is the scope of this unit, market failure, as a part of the chapter 2 related to public finance. First of all, let us understand what is the concept of market failure. When can we say that market failure happened? What kind of situation can be called as a market failure? It is a situation in which the free market leads to misallocation of society's scarce resources. Always we have to keep in mind, the basic economic problem is always the same. Resources are scarce, requirements are many, and the economic system, whatever it is supposed to allocate the resources properly so that the scarce resources are used efficiently and effectively. But if the market economy, free market economy, fails to allocate the scarce resources of society in a proper manner, we can call that as misallocation. And how that misallocation will be manifested in the form of either overproduction or underproduction. Any of them can happen in the form of overproduction or underproduction. Any of them can happen related to any particular goods and services. So overproduction also is possible. Underproduction is also possible. Overproduction means what? In a simple way, supply is more than demand. Underproduction means what? Demand is more than supply. That means the demand and supply are not matching. Why is it happening? Because the market has misallocated the resources. So that is a situation in which we can say the market has failed. That is a failure of the market. Failure does not mean we will dismantle it and completely throw it away. We cannot do that because the system is that. Somehow we have to rectify. For example, if any part of the body has a problem, we are not going to cut that part and throw it away always. It has to be rectified. Some medicine has to be given so that such part of the body will be healed. And who will give that medicine is government. What kind of medicines it will give, that we'll discuss later. But first of all, what is the problem that we should identify? So this is basically a chapter where we are diagnosing the reasons for market failure. For that to understand, first of all, we should know what can we call as a disease. When can we say that there is a market failure? Simply speaking, we can say the market has failed where misallocation of resources happened, and because of that, overproduction or underproduction of particular goods or services is happening, and as a result of that, ultimately what is happening is there is a suboptimal outcome. Suboptimal means less than optimal. There could have been a better outcome, but the market was not able to achieve that best outcome. It has achieved something inferior to what it could have achieved. That's what we call suboptimal outcome. Less than optimal outcome is achieved by market. So when you achieve anything less than your potential, that is a failure. And market has achieved less than its potential. That means market has failed in such a situation. And how can the market failures happen? Of course, there can be two sides of market failures. There can be a demand side market failure, or there can be a supply side market failures also. Both are possible. In any economy, naturally macroeconomic considerations, when we look at, both sides will have to be looked at for understanding purposes. Demand side is also there, supply side is also there. For example, if there is overproduction, that means what happened? Lot of production is there, supply is more, but demand is not there. Why is it not there? Are people mad? Why are they not buying? They should buy, no? Maybe they don't have incomes. Maybe they don't have jobs. Maybe the situation is not good for them that they can actually afford to buy the goods and services. What are the reasons for it? They have to be analyzed. But definitely that is a problem for sure. When overproduction happened, the stocks are piled up, and the sellers are not in a position to sell their output, is definitely a problem. That means there is a problem of demand. That is a failure on the demand side market. And if at all government intervenes into that side of the market, what it should do? It should do pumping of money into the people's pockets. That's what most of the economists recently, particularly the welfare economists, are suggesting the government, though the government is not accepting. That's a different story. But the suggestions came from many prominent economists, including Abhijit Banerjee and Raghuram Rajan, ex-RBI governor. Most of the famous international, Arvind Subramaniam, all our Indian, internationally renowned economists have been suggesting the government to give more money to the people now, particularly when the COVID and the corona situation has reduced the demand, because people don't have money. How can that demand be increased? By giving some money to the people. Of course, there are counter arguments. How can you give just like that freely money to people? That is also there. But the point is, demand side market failures happen when there is overproduction. That means the demand is not able to match with the supply. who failed? Demand has failed. Production happened, but people are not ready to buy. So demand side issue is there. Problem is there on that side. That is one scenario. Another scenario is supply side market failure. That's what when happens when the suppliers are not in a position to produce as much as required by the consumers. That means there is underproduction. So if there is underproduction, that is a supply side failure. If there is overproduction, that is a demand side failure. So problem is on one of the sides. Of course, at a broader level, the economic policies of governments can also be considered demand side policies and supply side policies. Demand side policies will try to increase and enhance the demand. Naturally, the only way of that is giving more and more money to the people, of course, through various modes, not just freely always, sometimes creating a lot of new jobs and new works. Also, money can be kept into the people's pockets. That will eventually increase the demand. That is one side of the policy. Supply side policies are those which will give incentives to the industries. The companies, corporates will get tax cuts. For example, India has announced a corporate tax cut heavily in the past 3-4 years, which is good. But from which side it is good? From the supply side it is good. So what is the expectation of the government? Okay, when you cut the corporate tax rate, the corporates will have excess cash with them because they are not paying that much tax now to the government. That excess cash they will invest and they will increase the capacities and increase the operations. That might generate employment and that will eventually kick the overall economy to grow up. Is the idea. Whether it really happens or not, always is a different story. Always. Any suggestions, any policies, all theoretical things that we talk may or may not actually have the real impact when they are actually implemented. That's a different story. We don't have to get into that. But what kind of a policy is that? That is a supply side policy. That is supporting whom? Supporting the supply side, supporting the corporates, supporting the companies, organizations with a tax benefit to them in the form of lower tax rates. That is a supply side policy of the government. Demand side policies will give tax cuts in indirect taxes. For example, if the GST rates are reduced, imagine, though they are not, if they are reduced, who will get benefited ultimately? Ideally, though not immediately, but ideally, the final consumer will get benefited, which means they'll have more disposable income in future to spend. That's a demand side policy. So cutting down indirect taxes is a kind of demand side policy. Demand side boost will be there. And cutting down corporate taxes will be a supply side policy. Depending upon the policies and decisions of any government in the world, they will take any of those decisions and they implement them. All that we need to know is what is the kind of policy that any government is implementing. But the point is, that is about the solution. But we are not talking about solution yet. We are still talking about the problem. So problem can be there either from the demand side or from the supply side. But solution cannot be given to both sides at the same time. That is the problem. So solution will be given only to one side. That will eventually over a period of time solve the other side also, because these two are not different. That point we have to understand. Demand and supply are two sides of the same coin. You cannot say one side is better than the other side. We cannot say that. Both are two sides of the same coin. But problems can happen on any of the sides. And that is how the markets fail. If there is a overproduction or underproduction of the goods and services in a particular economy, which leads to suboptimal outcomes. That's what is market failure in a nutshell. Of course, what are the reasons for market failure? This can be a question. Any of these things can be a question, by the way. Why do markets fail? There are four reasons, broadly speaking, as we already discussed. What are the four reasons? First reason is market power, then externalities, then public goods, then incomplete information. So these are the four reasons because of which the markets can generally fail. And who told all this? There are many economists throughout many decades who have observed why the markets are failing. And each of them came out with their own thoughts. And finally, what we are learning here is the compilation of many, many economists' thoughts. It is not just about one person's thought. Many economists over the period of time, almost decades and almost a century, we can say. Since a century, what is the reason for market failures has been researched, and what is the outcome, at least as of now, is there are broadly four reasons: market power, externalities, failure of markets to provide public goods. Don't say public goods is a failure. Public goods itself is not a bad thing. But markets fail to provide public goods, that is a failure of the market. So public goods is one of the reasons for market failure. And incomplete information definitely is bad, and that prevails in the market. That results in market failure. And this unit is all about knowing each of these things in detail. So naturally, let us start with the first one. What is market power? Market power, simply monopoly, we can say. Market power is nothing but monopoly power. See, monopoly as a concept or as a theory says, there should be only one supplier, there should not be any competitors. I mean, practically it is impossible, almost in any field. Even though you take Google and companies like that as monopoly, but still it is not 100% monopoly. There are still other search engines, there are still other companies which are providing similar services. So 100% monopoly is not possible. But the point is not about always 0% or 100%. That is the point we have to always keep in mind. Is there a substantial power that few companies are exerting on the entire market or not? If yes, that's what we call it as a monopoly power, and that creates a market power. Means few organizations can control and completely dominate the market. And that is what is called as market power. So that is a monopoly power or market power. What is it? Is ability of a firm to profitably raise the market price of a good or service over and above its marginal cost. What is the proof of that? Okay, we may say this company has domination on the market, or that brand has domination on the market. That doesn't matter. But from a technical point of view, when can we say a particular firm has monopoly power is when they can raise the market price over and above its marginal cost. Under ideal circumstances, the price of a particular commodity should be equal to its marginal cost. That means whatever the additional cost is incurred to produce one more commodity should be the price that is charged from that additional customer. Ideally speaking, theoretically speaking. But if there are organizations which are having the ability to increase the prices according to their whims and fancies, that too above the marginal cost, that is a representation, that is a reflection of market power or monopoly power. But one point here we have to remember and we have to recollect, the point of cost also. Marginal cost is which marginal cost are we talking? Are we talking about only the cost of production, etc.? Are we talking about accounting costs? No, we are not talking about accounting costs. We are talking about economic costs, of course, which include opportunity costs. So if any organization is able to make positive economic profits, that is when we can say that firm is having market power. When it is having positive economic profits, naturally, when it is able to sell the goods or services over and above its marginal cost, once again, I'm repeating, this marginal cost is not accounting cost. This is economic cost. So if the price of a commodity is more than its marginal economic cost, if at all the price of a commodity is more than its marginal economic cost, then that firm is said to be having market power or monopoly power. Not the other tests that is it the only firm, are there any other firms also, those things all will not matter. When we say monopoly or market power is when price of a commodity that a firm is able to charge from its consumers is exceeding its marginal economic cost. In other words, the same thing can be reframed in a different way. So when can we say the firm has market power? Are those which are price makers, means they have the ability to control the price and they can charge a price that gives them positive economic profits. Both are same. When you say price is more than marginal economic cost, that means it is resulting in a positive economic profit. Ideally, once again, theoretically speaking, no firm in general under competition can make positive economic profits. At the maximum, it can make zero economic profits. Of course, it can make positive accounting profits, not positive economic profits. What is the difference? Economic profits include accounting profits, or we can say economic costs include accounting costs and opportunity costs. So naturally, the economic costs will be always more than the accounting costs. Economic profits will be always less than the accounting profits. But here, under normal perfect competition, if at all that ideal situation exists, no firm can make positive economic profits. But if the firms are able to make positive economic profits, that means they have market power. They are price makers. They have monopoly power. That is the indication of market power or monopoly power in a technical manner. Of course, what happens here? If a particular firm or a few firms have this market power, that causes a single producer or some small number of producers to produce and sell less output that would have been produced in a competitive market. Because they have market power, because they have monopoly power, they will not produce as much as they should produce, they will produce less. Why? To keep the demand intact and to keep the price high. To keep the price high, because they can charge higher prices because of their power. So that is definitely a suboptimal outcome. Ideally, there is supposed to be some level of production which should cater to the people of a country. If few firms have market power, what they will do? They will produce less output than that would have been produced in a competitive market. In other words, we can say that will lead to underproduction. And naturally, that will cause the markets to become inefficient. So inefficient markets means that is market failure. In other words, the market power or monopoly power that is enjoyed by few firms or one firm is going to lead to market failure because of inefficiency that is shown by them in the form of underproduction. That's what is the side effect or bad effect of market power. And that is definitely going to lead to market failure. That is one of the reasons of market failure, that is market power. We can take many examples. Particularly the companies like Apple have had this, we can say, ability, power, at least earlier, to charge the prices which are way above their marginal economic costs. Means they have made exorbitant profits. Companies like Apple made exorbitant profits by selling iPhones, iPads and other products of Apple. You can see that from their balance sheet and P&L account itself. But still, nobody could do anything. They had that power to charge that much from the customers. They are not forcing any customer to buy their phone. Customers are willing to pay. They are encashing that. They are basically milking the demand that they have throughout the world for the products what they produce. So they have that power. So that is where they enjoy kind of monopoly power. Of course, not completely now, because a lot of other competitive firms from Korea and China also are dominating the market. But we cannot see only India. At a global level, most of the other mobile phone manufacturers are in a very tough competition. Whereas Apple is still able to exert its power on the entire world mobile market. That is monopoly power or market power. It happens. Okay. Is it good or bad? Debatable. Whether it is going to lead to market failure? Definitely yes. It is not an ultimate good thing, because if they wanted, with their technology, they could have produced more and more phones and made it cheaper, but they don't do that. they produce lesser than what they could have produced, is the theory which says few firms will have market power over the entire market, and that is the evident in many sectors. But the problem is it is not completely checked, because it is part of the market, and that is the nature of the market, that some of the big firms, some of the big companies, big multinational corporations and corporates will exert market power. But theoretically, that is not going to be leading to an efficient market or an economy. So it will eventually lead to a problem. And what is the problem we are looking at? That problem is what we call as market failure. So one of the reasons for that market failure is monopoly power or market power. Now let us move on to another reason for market failure, that is externalities. Very important aspect. A lot of questions can be expected from this. Externalities. If you understand it, it is easy to answer. Nothing special or technical about it, but logic has to be understood properly. So what are externalities? Sometimes the actions of either consumers or producers, any of them, both will be there in any market. Without them, there is no market. Market itself is nothing but a place where the buyers and sellers are there. So producers also or consumers also can do something. They take some actions that results in costs or benefits to whom? Not to themselves, to others. And that do not reflect as part of the market price. So producers or consumers do something with their actions. They will cause either cost or benefit to whom? To somebody else. And in spite of that, that cost or benefit what these people are causing is not reflected in the market price. And such costs or benefits which are not accounted for by the market price are called as externalities. When we look at the costs or benefits related to a particular product or service, we only look at the actual costs which are incurred to produce that item or to render that service. But is it the real cost only? Actually, no. There are some costs which are external costs, which will cause cost or benefit to the others, and those costs or benefits are not accounted for in this market price of manufacturing any product or rendering any service, and those external costs are called as externalities. Of course, when we say costs, that could be benefit also. In other words, externalities could be positive also, externalities could be negative also. If the action of a consumer or producer is resulting in something good for others, that is called as positive externality, that is creating a benefit to others. And if the action of producers or consumers is creating a cost to others, that means it is a negative externality. Both are possible. But the point to note is, actions are done by somebody else. Impact of those actions is on somebody completely different persons or group of persons or the society as a whole. Then we call them as externalities, and these externalities are not accounted for in the market price. That is the main point to be noted. They are not generally accounted for if it is left to the market. Market doesn't care about them because they only look at the real costs that are incurred, and they will charge the market price after adding some profit to the cost. But what about the cost that indirectly is added to others or the society as a whole? That is not accounted for in the market price, and such kind of costs or benefits are called as externalities because they are external to the basic process of manufacturing and rendering of services. These are called externalities. Point to be noted once again here, who is causing is different. So cause and effect are different here. Cause is different. Effect is not on the same person. Effect is on some other person. For example, if somebody is having a big speaker, loud speaker, and playing music outside their premises, and that is causing problem to many people, let us say. There is a class that is going on adjacent to this loudspeaker, and all the students got disturbed by this, and whoever the teacher is, they could not actually deliver the classes because of the noise that is created by this loudspeaker. Just an example. So the point here is what? Who has caused it is a different party, and who has got affected is a different party. When this loudspeaker, let us say, is rented by that person, he would have paid some money. That is his real cost. But did he really take into consideration the loss of the man hours to both the teacher and the students? No, he did not. But did he really cause that loss? Yes, he did. But is it part of the price? No, it is not. That is what is externality. Who caused is different. Who got the effect of it is different. Of course, in general, we talk about negative things only in the externalities. Will there not be positive externalities? There will be also. But those are different. If somebody is having, let us say, some good odor, or let us say somebody is having oud or some samrani in their house, and that may create a good smell to other houses also adjacent, that is a positive externality. Now the point is, both are possible, though we just mostly focus on the negative things, because those are the costs which are not included in the market price. So core point as a conceptual thing in the understanding of concept of externalities is, they are caused by somebody else, but effect is on completely different people or group of people. So cause and effect is not necessarily on the same person. That is the first point. And they may be sometimes reciprocal also. They may be unidirectional, or even they can be reciprocal also. So this same example, if you take, the loudspeaker guy was creating nuisance by playing loud music and disturbing the class. Just imagine, all the students came out and they were shouting, just like that, in order to disturb the other guy. So that could be reciprocal, possible. They can stop the person who has paid money to actually enjoy that loud music from enjoying it. They were all shouting, they're stopping that person from enjoying that loud music. So he was disturbing the class one way, and he got it reciprocated by the others, possible. In that case, we call it as reciprocal externality. Sometimes it could be, see, in general, it is unidirectional. In general, they are negative. Though externalities may be unidirectional or reciprocal, they can be positive or negative. Yes, all are possible and all we should know. But practically speaking, most of the cases they are unidirectional, most of the cases they are negative. And what are the other names that we can give about externalities? We can use any other words also. They can be called as spillover effects. Spillover effects is one word used for it. Or we can call it as neighborhood effects, or third party effects, or side effects of anything. Because the originator of the externality imposes costs or benefits on others who are not responsible for initiating the effect. So effect is on somebody else. Who is originating that cause is somewhere else. An originator doesn't care about that impact on others. That is a problem. Originator will do according to his whims and fancies, but that will have a negative or positive impact on others. And those people who are actually bearing that cost or benefit are not responsible for initiating that. Somebody else has initiated that. If it is a benefit, that means the people who have enjoyed that benefit from others' actions are enjoying it freely. If it is a cost, they are bearing that pain which is caused by somebody else. So the point once again to note here very clearly is, externalities are caused by somebody and its effect is on somebody else. Okay, they may be positive or negative. Rarely they could be even reciprocal also, but in general they are unidirectional. That is about externalities, and we should understand this concept of externalities in multiple aspects. What are the types of externalities? Possible question. There are four types of externalities. Negative production externalities. Broadly, there are positive and negative. When you say externalities, they are positive, either positive externalities or negative externalities. Both are possible. And positive externalities also can happen from production side or consumption side. Negative externalities can also happen from production side or consumption side. That's it. These are the four things. So negative production externalities, positive production externalities. Same way. Negative consumption externalities and positive consumption externalities. So when we say production or consumption, here we are talking about the originator. When you say it is a production externality, who is causing it, whether it is positive or negative, that is happening in the way of production. So imagine if it instead of loudspeaker, it is a machine that is running, which is creating lot of noise and that is disturbing everybody in that locality. Big machine is there and making lot of noise. So that is a production negative externality. Why? Because it is caused by somebody in the process of production. That is negative production externality. So whenever we say production externality or consumption externality, we should understand we are not talking about the effect on whom. Effect can be always on both cases. So this positive or negative production or consumption externality, each of them can have an effect on the producers also and consumers also. Again, each of them has a possibility to impact production or consumption. Both sides it will have. So each of them is again having the possibility, is that we have to understand. So when we say production or consumption, we are not talking about the other side which is receiving end. We are talking about who is causing it. And naturally, who is causing will be depicted by the name of it. If it is a production externality, it is caused in the process of production. Impact of that could be on production or consumption. But if it is a consumption externality, whether positive or negative, if it is a consumption externality, that is happening while somebody is consuming something. For example, somebody is smoking, is consuming, is not producing anything, is not producing some clouds or something, is consuming something bad. And that creates a negative consumption externality. And that could be impacting badly others also. And others could be again impacted in their production process or consumption process. Let us say somebody is smoking and there is one person who is enjoying an ice cream adjacent, and that person is not able to enjoy the ice cream because there is a person who is smoking adjacent to him. That means a negative consumption externality caused other consumption to be hampered by it. Something negative happened because of that. On whom? Not on the production. On the consumption. On the other side, if because of this person who is consuming a negative thing, something like doing smoking, if this is causing a disturbance, or this has created a disturbance to the workers who are working adjacent to this person who is smoking, then that has created a problem. Who created it? Not in production. Creation happened in consumption only. But where it impacted on production. So the point again to note is, when we say production externality or consumption externality, we are talking about the origination. And destination of or effect of this can be always on either side. Effect could be bad or good. Effect could be on production also and consumption also. That is always possible. But that is not what we look at when we give name of production externality or consumption externality. When we say production externality, that is created in the process of production. When we say consumption externality, that is created in the process of consumption. That is a very important point to note. So we are looking at from the originator's point of view, not from the person who is suffering or enjoying. Who is creating it, from that point of view, these names are given. That if you understand that logic, each of these things can be understood very simply and easily. So what are these negative production externalities? Let us look at each of them one by one. First thing first, negative, that is production externalities. Of course, it is negative means something bad is happening. That is for sure. Bad is happening when? When in the process of production. So who is creating it? In the process of production, somebody is creating something bad. Impact of this can be there again, always on production also, consumption also. That is different story. But who is causing it is in the process of production only. That is happening, and that too, it is not a good thing that is happening. It is a bad thing happening. So we are calling it as a negative production externality. Name itself indicates. Negative indicates bad. Production externality indicates it is originated, initiated in the production. So a negative externality initiated in the production. And of course, that imposes external cost. How do we know it is cost, not benefit? Because we are talking about negative. If it was positive, we would have called it a benefit. But now this negative externality is initiated in the production process, which is imposing an external cost on whom? On somebody else, on others, not themselves, on others, and which could be received by the others. That others can be receiving it in consumption or production. That is always common. This sentence is always common, which could be received by others whenever the whatever the situation they are actually in. They could be impacted in their production process, or they could be impacted badly in their consumption process. Both are possible. So if that thing happens, that is called negative production externality. So they are initiated in the production process naturally, and that is creating something bad. So we are calling it as an external cost, which is imposed by somebody in the process of production, but that has impact negatively on others. And those others could be having this impact in their process of consumption or production, as the case may be. So that is negative production externalities. Understand this with examples, and you can write them in exam also, no problem. Or you can create your own examples, no problem. If you understand the concept, easy to create examples. Any number of examples can be imagined and written. But simply to take what are the popular examples of negative production externalities. Thermal power plants, for example, creating pollution, which is common. And why only thermal power plants are? Because it is example. So many factories are there. Every factory will have pollution. Definitely it will create air pollution, water pollution, sometimes even noise pollution with their big, big machinery and all. Possible. Lot of pollution they create. Okay, let us focus only on examples. So thermal power plant, let us say, is there at one place. It is creating pollution. All its effluents and waste things, it is leaving it to the nearby canal, which, let us say, canal is leaving all those bad toxic waste into the nearby river. That is an example we are looking at. What kind of externality this factory is creating? It is creating a negative production externality. Simply they will throw all their wastage into this canal and they are okay with that. They are silent. But is it creating a problem to others or not? Definitely yes. And it can create a problem in others' production also, in others' consumption also. Imagine, because of this pollution, the water in that area, groundwater, has completely contaminated, and people who are consuming that water are getting sick. Imagine, that means the impact of this negative production externality is on the others' consumption. On the other side, let us say this effluents which have been left into the river have killed the fish which are normally supposed to be there in that area, and because of which the fishermen could not actually catch good healthy fish. So what it has caused? This negative production externality has caused problem to another production process. Fishing is also another production process. Any economic activity is a production process. So that is the two ways effect. Both are possible. Every time we don't have to go into both of them. We have to just commonly understand one thing. Impact could be there in all the cases. Impact could be there on the others' production or others' consumption always. Always both are possible. But who is creating it is what we are looking at. Who is creating it? In this case, production process is creating. Thermal power plant is creating this pollution. That is a negative production externality. Same way, somebody is using lot of pesticides while manufacturing or producing or cultivating fruits and vegetables. that creates a negative production externality. Maybe you cannot see that immediately, but that will hamper the health of many people when they consume these fruits and vegetables. Quite possible. So that can create a negative production externality. That is one of the examples. Same way, sucking the groundwater dry for manufacturing aerated drinks, something like, let us say, Coca-Cola or Pepsi, they will need a lot of water. You can imagine how much water they will require. They have to clean the bottles if they are glass bottles. For that, they need water. And they need water, first of all, for their drink itself. Lots of water, gallons, millions and billions of gallons of water they require. Where from they will take? Either from the rivers nearby or groundwater they will take. And there, wherever the groundwater is sucked by these companies in the form of manufacturing cool drinks, it is a proven fact that in the nearby localities, the farmers are not able to find groundwater easily. These companies can go as much deeper as they want because they have money. They can dig meters and meters together into the ground and suck the water. What about a normal farmer? He would have some pipe and he would have had some bore pump, bore well, up to certain level of depth. And at that level, water is gone. And somebody else has already sucked it out. So where this farmer will get the water? Difficult. That means what? This particular, let us say, soft drink company is creating a negative production externality, which is impacting the production of something else. That is one thing. Of course, this may even cause a consumption externality also, because people might be having problem with basic drinking water itself. Normal people in the villages may be suffering from drinking water problem, but around them there is a big factory which is producing soft drinks and sending to nook and corner of the country. So this negative production externality can have an impact on the others' consumption also, others' production also. Always possible, the other side. But who is creating it? The one who is doing some production process. So these are some of the examples. Like this, hundreds and hundreds of examples can be taken. You see them every day. Many, many production processes, whether it is a normal factories or whether it is some of the manufacturers, they keep on creating, even for that matter, agriculturalists also, with the use of heavy pesticides and fertilizers. They are creating negative production externalities. So many of these things keep on happening daily, and that is one of the things that happen. The point is, how to stop it and all, we are not discussing now. That will be the topic of next unit. But will it happen normally? Yes, it is common. It is common that negative production externalities are always there, of course, from the supply side, from the manufacturer's side, these things will happen. In general, service sector may not have very big negative production externality in general, but not necessarily always. Even service sector also sometimes can create negative production externalities. Now, if you see the, let us say, news channel debates, some of the debates, particularly national level news channels, they are creating a negative production externality because they are creating hatred, they are creating fear, and they are creating bigotry, and they are creating a problem in the minds of the people, always shouting and all, as if like the world is going to fall tomorrow or now. What is that happening? People are having their blood pressure levels increased, and people are always suspecting everybody else around them. People are having negative thoughts about them, others. Instead of love, they are spreading hatred. So it will definitely have a huge impact on the society in the coming days. But the point is, nobody pays for it. Because if it is left uncontrolled, this negative production externalities will create problem on others. They will be happy. They will have their own advertisement money. They will be roaming in big cars. They are happy. They know that also. They are causing this negative production externality and simply enjoying their wealth. That's okay. But who has to curb it? In all the cases or examples we have taken, naturally the government. Of course, how should it do and all, we will discuss in the next unit. So these are some of the examples of negative production externalities. Imagine if a chartered accountant is encouraging the client to pay some bribe to the income tax officer, is also a negative production externality. It is, because he's creating a corruption. And that is also a negative production externality. A lawyer who is completely supporting and trying to make a murder victim escape from the law is also creating a negative production externality. So there are possibilities in service sector also, but in general, if you look at tangible things, every factory that we see, every manufacturing unit that we see keeps on creating negative production externality. The biggest of them throughout the world is naturally pollution. Pollution is the biggest and most dangerous negative production externality, which is there, which is a reality, whether we like it or not. That is one of the types of externalities. Now we can look at the other types. Positive production externalities will be there also or not? Will there be some positive production externalities also? Always will there be negative only? There is possibility of positive also. So what are those? Definition, if you observe, only few words will change. Remaining else will be all same. What is positive external, positive production externality? Of course, it is a positive externally externality which is initiated in the production process, because this is production initiation we are looking at, and that is conferring. Earlier, what word you used? That was imposing an external cost. Now it is conferring, giving actually an external benefit. To whom? Others, naturally, always others. And the last line is always them, which could be received by the others in consumption or in production. The last line is not going to change in all the four categories. Which could be received by others in consumption or production is same standard. But who is initiating it? Here also it is initiated in the production process. Of course, that is why we are calling it as production externality. But is it a positive or negative thing? In this case, it is a positive thing. It is a good thing. So what it is doing? It is giving or conferring an external benefit to others. That's it. That is positive production externality. Some of the examples can be taken, though they are rare. Actually, positive things are very rare, particularly externalities. But yes, training and development of employees is a positive production externality. Companies spend a lot of money on the training and development of employees. Is it useful for the same company throughout the life? Generally, no. The same people who are trained, who got good training in one company, after a few years, they jumped to another company. Other company actually got them almost free. They don't have to spend again on training and development of them. So in other words, in a general level, the training and development of employees by the companies in their production process creates skilled people, better people, professional people, and that is good for the entire society and other companies also. So that is how positive production externality is created, through training and development. Or another example can be taken, like an apple farmer or any other fruit farmer and a beekeeper. Two people are there. There is one apple farm, and adjacently nearby there is a bee honey manufacturing bee farm, let us say. There is a beekeeper who is cultivating bees and is collecting honey from them. Both of them get mutually benefited. Why? Because these bees will go and increase the overall crop for the apple farmer. And from the apple farmer's farm, in which the small flowers are there and from which the honey is being taken, beekeeper is getting honey. So both are getting benefited, and it is good, positive. That is a very positive production externality. It is reciprocal actually. When we said earlier, sometimes externalities can be reciprocal. This is an example of reciprocal positive externality, apple farmer and a beekeeper. Example like this, any other farm also can be taken. For example, another thing, like practically what happened, like Tim Berners-Lee developed this World Wide Web, WWW, what we call, and he made it freely available, and he created a very large positive externality. All these years, entire world, we are using this World Wide Web, internet, what we are calling. This World Wide Web was created and made freely available to all of us. How big positive externality that person has created in that process. Fantastic point and fantastic contribution to the humankind, we can say. That is a positive production externality. So these type of positive production externalities also happen. Let us say a lawyer goes and takes the case of a poor person and argues for that poor person's rights in the court of law. That is a positive production externality. Like that, anybody doing a positive thing, it gives an external benefit to not himself. It is giving an external benefit to others. That is a positive production externalities, and generally they are rare. Not that they do not happen. There are many people who create positive production externalities, but yes, more than them, unfortunately, the negative production externalities are dominating entire world. If we see, rarely positive production externalities also happen, which will give some benefit to the others. With the actions of one person, he is giving benefit to others, knowingly or unknowingly. Other person doesn't, maybe does not even know that also, but still he has created a very good benefit to the entire society and others. And others might get the benefit of this while they are producing or consuming something else. So that kind of benefit, if it is created, that is called a positive production externality, because it is created in the process of production. It is initiated in production. That is one more type of externality. So those are the two production externalities. One is negative production externality. Other one is positive production externality. Now let us move on to consumption externalities. Production externalities will be caused by those who produce, naturally. Consumption externalities will be caused by those who consume. And while consuming, they may create negative externalities also or positive also. So where it is initiated? Initiated in consumption, not production. And because we are looking at negative, this is a negative externality initiated in consumption that imposes an external cost. Whenever it is negative, it imposes a cost on whom? Always others. The person who is creating it will be happy, but it will create a negative externality on the others. And others could be receiving it in the consumption or production. This is always the same. It could be received by others in consumption or in production. We don't have to look at that line always. That is the same point in all the four categories of externalities. So in case of negative consumption externality, it is initiated in the consumption. And since it is negative, it is imposing an external cost on whom? On somebody else. And how the others are taking it? Maybe they are taking it while they are consuming something or producing something. That is called negative consumption externalities. We see this every day. This is quite common on the road, wherever we see, if at all we go outside. Everywhere we see this negative consumption externalities who create problem to others. They don't care about others. Smoking in public places is one of the very classic examples of it, because it creates a lot of problem, and passive smoking is also dangerous for others. And others will get health problems also because of the actions of somebody who is creating this negative consumption externality. While he consumes his own cigarette or something, he is creating problems to others. So that is an example of negative consumption externality. Let us say somebody is playing loud music, like example that we have taken earlier, or somebody is consuming alcohol at work. He is creating a problem, and that is impacting production also. That might impact production also. Okay, it may sound like fashionable when we see Arjun Reddy and Kabir Singh type of movies, that some doctor drinks and goes to perform a surgery. That is ridiculous. That is absolutely ridiculous, and no doctor can do that, should do that, because every doctor will not be a film hero that he performs the surgery always correct. So the point is that creates a very big, dangerous, negative consumption externality, because he is consuming a bad thing like alcohol while at work, and that is going to impact his production or service, whatever he is rendering. So others will get affected. If a doctor is consuming alcohol at the time of doing surgery, as fashionably shown in Arjun Reddy's and Kabir Singh's, that is going to not affect him anyway. He will have his own effects later. But what about the patient? If the patient dies, that is the responsibility of the doctor. And because of the irresponsibility of the doctor, the patient died. Imagine, that is going to be a very big problem. And that is an example of negative consumption externality. Lot of people do this, and they think it is fashionable thing. Same way, like let us say some young person going on the road very rashly on the bike. We see that daily, no? We see that. That is a negative consumption externality. Because of that, somebody else might fall. Somebody else might have a problem. He might have got accident because of this. Maybe this person might not be there in that accident. He will just like that quickly go. But that might have caused an accident which he doesn't even see and look back. That a lot of times it so happens. People actually a lot of times get involved into accidents, not because of their mistakes. Mostly they get involved into accidents because of somebody else's mistake, mostly. And that somebody will be generally escaping. he will not be there. So what is that role of the other person? He is creating a negative consumption externality and he is impacting the others badly, negatively, and creating an external cost on the others. Like this, we see irresponsible behavior, simply we can say, from many people, and that creates a negative consumption externality, and that will impact others badly. So that is about negative consumption externality. Will there not be positive consumption externalities? Of course, there could be positive things also. Again, in case it is positive, it is creating an external benefit to whom? Others. And it is initiated where? Consumption, because we are looking at positive consumption externality. Same thing. Definition is same, only few words are changing, you have to observe that. A positive externality, which is initiated in the consumption, that confers an external benefit on others, which could be received by the others either in consumption or in production. That is called a positive consumption externality. So the person who is creating it doesn't even know that, or maybe he is not doing it with an intention or without intention. But ultimately, because of his actions, he is creating a good thing or good impact on others, and he is creating external benefit to others. Examples of positive consumption externalities are generally very limited, in fact, but unfortunately, though they are limited, we have to just give some examples for understanding purposes. Say somebody is getting vaccinated. That means he is creating a positive consumption externality. He is consuming the vaccine, not like eating it or drinking it. He is taking it by whatever means it is. Some vaccines are given orally, some vaccines are given in the form of injection, whatever it is. But what he is doing actually, he is stopping a contagious disease. He himself getting vaccinated, somebody, he is creating a positive externality, and that could benefit others. And how is he creating? Is he producing the vaccine? No, he himself just getting vaccinated. Actually, he is getting vaccinated for himself. But by doing so, he is not giving advantage to himself. He is also giving advantage to the entire society, because he is going to stop the spread of communicable diseases. So that is one example of positive consumption externality. Actually, really studying properly itself is a very good positive consumption externality. A lot of people don't know that. They think it is just some burden. No, it is not. Going to a good college, university or institution and studying a good course, let us say joining chartered accountancy and finishing this course, becoming a chartered accountant itself is a positive consumption externality, because it is going to create a lot of benefit to the entire society. We have to understand, without doing this, with this. Without doing this, probably something is there. By doing this, if a person is able to get better education, he might motivate and he might influence and he might give knowledge to others, and he might earn income and spend in the economy, that will boost the economy. So when students are learning, they are not just learning only for the immediate benefit. That is an investment that they are doing now in the form of time and some money, the benefits of which will come in the future. And those benefits are not restricted to the learner or student only. Those benefits will accrue. First, they accrue to the family, and then they accrue to the entire society in a positive way. So doing good things by joining even a good college, university or institution, learning good things itself is a positive consumption externality that can be benefited, or that can be giving benefit to others in future. So that is also another example of positive consumption externality. Contrary to the rash driving, if somebody is driving carefully by just following the rules, that is a positive consumption externality. A lot of times it so happens, let us say traffic signals are there, no police is there, no traffic police, but there is a red signal. That is a litmus test. How many people will actually stop at a red signal when there is no police at that post? Very few. But those who are stopping are creating a positive consumption externality. They are telling others indirectly, boss, you are not following the rules because of police or because of somebody watching you. You are following rules because they are rules. You are supposed to follow them. Unless it is an emergency, like an ambulance or something, you are not supposed to break the rules, irrespective of whether somebody is watching you or not. So that is the example they are setting, and that creates a civic sense on the others also, at least on some few more people. And that is a positive consumption externality. If somebody is driving carefully by following the rules, others also slowly, not immediately, it will not happen just like that, but it will and probably might create a positive impact on the entire society, and it will not happen in one day. See, a lot of times we see this general comment, or in other countries, people are all like going in lanes, or very good lane discipline is there when they drive. Why in India we are going so zigzag and all? Oh, we don't have civic sense, we don't have common sense. Like that, we keep people, especially those who return from other countries, NRIs type of people, will always moan about it. Are it will not happen just like that. There should be considerable number of people who follow it, and slowly others will also follow it. It is not something that can be imposed only, always. That is our problem. We will not do anything unless it is imposed. That is our problem. As long as that is there, naturally the progress of the country will be in peril. We should not be in that mindset at all. We should do good things because they are good things. Not because somebody told us, not because somebody is watching us whether we are doing it or not. We have to do it because it is a good thing. As simple as that. And that is the attitude which is required. And that is developed not in one day or 2 days. It is developed over decades, and lot of time it will take. When, let us say, so-called developed countries have got cars, and when we have got cars, there is a lot of difference. There is a difference of at least 5-6 decades when most of the people got cars in their hands. So you expect that suddenly everybody who got a car will get to understand how to drive also. What is the civic sense also? What is the driving sense also? Lane discipline. All these things will not happen just like that. Yes, there will be rules, there will be fines. All these things will be there. But still, most of the people will not actually follow them with their intention. And they don't understand the importance of that. But yes, if somebody is following it, however small the number may be, they are creating a positive consumption externality. That is an example of various types of externalities. So in a nutshell, there are 4 types of externalities: negative production externality, positive production externality, negative consumption externalities, positive consumption externalities. You should be able to define them, and you should be able to write some examples, perfect questions. Any of them, one of them can be asked. Very important aspect of categories or types of externalities. Conceptually, if you understand, it is not going to be very difficult. You just have to write correct words. You have to use the words. When you say cost, you have to use the word imposed by one person on others. If you say benefit, we have to say it is conferring an external benefit on others. Where is it initiated? That depends upon the name itself. If it is a production externality, it is initiated in production. If it is a consumption externality, it is initiated in consumption. If it is a positive externality, it is creating an external benefit. If it is a negative externality, it is creating an external cost. That is about externalities in a nutshell. Now, another important concept is social cost. A lot of times, we don't even care about it. Say, the same person who is going very rashly on a bike on the roads doesn't know what kind of social cost he is creating. He doesn't know that. Same way, an industry which is creating pollution is not aware of the social cost it is creating. It is only interested in the private cost. But now that we know externalities, we have to understand social costs are more than private costs. What are the social costs here? They refer to the total cost to the society. Name itself indicates. Social cost means the cost incurred by entire society on account of the production or consumption activity, of course. Due to what? Due to externalities. And social costs are nothing but, of course, the private costs borne by the individuals directly involved in a transaction. But that does not only stop there. Together with, means plus, external cost borne by third parties not directly involved in that transaction. So simply speaking, social cost is nothing but private cost plus external cost. Private cost is incurred by the person who is incurring itself. External cost is not incurred by that person, that is incurred by others. Just imagine, I am actually a live example of this also. I was born in a town where there was a sugar factory. And almost in my entire childhood, till my 10th standard, I was in that same town. Later, I moved on to further education and hostels, etc. Later. But almost for a period of, say, 12 years, when we were there in that town, every year, I used to have problems in breathing. I used to have kind of asthma, and always my nose was flowing only. Means always there was cold, always, almost throughout the year. Jovially, I used to say, I get cold twice a year, and every time it comes, it stays for 6 months. So that was the situation. I was not aware what was the reason and all. A lot of doctors have shown. Of course, cold is not something that people will take too seriously also. But still, problem was there. But after I moved out of that town and went to other places for further education and all, surprisingly, I came to know that this problem has vanished. And over a period of time, it was not there at all. I was okay with that. Slowly, I came to realize this happened only because of the sugar factory which was located in our town. That sugar factory, it is a very huge sugar factory, and that sugar factory used to emit so much of air pollution, and that much of air pollution was accumulated in our lungs, and that we were all inhaling daily. That means we never knew that there is something called fresh air, because we were born there only and we were there brought up. We didn't know that this air is contaminated. The water that we drink or we used to drink was contaminated. The air that we used to breathe was contaminated. We didn't know that. But it was creating a lot of health problems to us. I am just one person. Like this, there are 50,000 people in that town. Each of them had some problem or the other. Now the question is, this sugar factory is creating and producing sugar. Are we saying that they should not produce sugar? Then people will not have sugar. That is not the point here. They are producing sugar. So what is the cost of production of that sugar? They will say, we know that, oh, material cost, labor cost, overhead cost, all these things they will add. So that's all is the cost of production of sugar. After that, storage, etc., etc., they will add selling and distribution expenses, administration, etc. Adding profit, they sell this sugar in the market. Sugar is available in the market for, just for example, let us say 20 rupees per kg. That is the market price of sugar. Yes. For some time, forget about price. Let us say 20 rupees is the cost of manufacturing 1 kg of sugar. Does this 20 rupees include all my medical bills? I paid the medical bills for my problem. And who caused that? The process of manufacturing this sugar only caused that. Because of that only, I had this medical problem. Because of which only, I had to spend a lot of money. I mean, my family had to spend a lot of money to doctors. So many times I was sick. Is the cost of manufacturing of sugar going to include my medical bill or the medical bills of all the 50,000 people around that factory? Answer is no. That is the problem. That is the danger, or that is the negative thing that production process causes. That is the externality. So, what is the cost here that the sugar factory is incurring to manufacture sugar? Is their private cost, that we know. For this only we have subject called costing. So private cost is ascertainable, easy. So I'll add all the costs, material, labor, overheads, etc., etc. You have the private cost computed. For that we have professionals like cost accountant, chartered accountants working for these companies. Yes, fantastic. But is it the social cost? No, because the social cost is much bigger than this private cost. Because the social cost should include external cost also. External cost is what? In our example, all the medical expenses of the 50,000 people who suffered because of that factory and paid money to doctors all their life is the external cost, which is not accounted for in that private cost of manufacturing that sugar. That is the external cost. So the social cost caused by this sugar factory is much more than the private cost what they are incurring. That is the point of social cost. So social cost is always more than the private cost. Of course, when there is a negative externality, if it is a positive externality, then the social cost will be less than private cost, which is a rare thing. So let us not go into that. In general, externality means negative only. So when we say external cost, it is a negative externality. So negative externality has created a problem on others, and that cost which is associated with that problem is not accounted for in the private cost. But if we want to see the social cost of this entire process of production, we cannot only look at private cost. We have to look at private cost plus external cost also. That is the point to be noted, and that's what is social cost all about. So what is the reason for social cost to exist, which is different from private cost? Simply speaking, the presence of externalities that creates a divergence between the private cost and social cost of production. In other words, private cost and social costs are not equal. In general, because of negative externalities, the social costs are more than private costs. And this applies to almost every manufacturing industry. Every industry. Manufacturing will not happen without pollution, not possible. And without manufacturing, we cannot have all our comforts, all our luxuries, and all our necessities also. So that is the paradox, and that is where the balance has to be struck. Who will do that? Once again, government has to do that. How? That we'll see later. But is there a problem here? If we left the market, we left the producers, we left the manufacturers according to their whims and fancies, what they will do? Oh, they will create havoc. They will cause so much of social cost, and that will be more and much more than the private cost that those producers will incur. Because they are not incurring the external cost, somebody else is bearing, they don't care. That is a problem. They don't care. But somebody has to care. Who is that? That should be government. We will see that later. So this is a very important aspect of externalities and what is the impact of externalities on the society in a nutshell. Now, okay, we know externalities. What types of externalities are there and how they will add to the private cost so that the social cost is more than private cost? We understood that. But how can they lead to market failure? We have to always keep in mind, four reasons are there for market failure. One, we discussed market power, monopoly power. We are in the second one, that is externality. How these externalities will lead to or can lead to market failure? That is what we have to also observe. This can be a question also. First point, the externalities will cause market inefficiencies because they hinder the ability of the market prices. See, the market price, what we looked at in the form of sugar, let us say as an example, is it conveying the accurate information about how much to produce and how much to consume? No, it is not, because it is underpriced. It was not taking the social costs. Earlier, we are taking 20 rupees as the cost. It was only private cost. It was not considering the social cost. In other words, what happened? That price of the sugar was underpriced, means too much of demand is there for that product now. And because of that demand, lot of production of sugar happens. And looking at this factory, somebody else will also start and they will manufacture some more sugar and they will cause more and more costs. So because of these externalities, particularly the negative externalities, market inefficiencies will be occurred. Why and how? Since they hinder the ability of the market prices, they will negatively impact the market prices' ability to convey the accurate information. Normally, what is the belief in the market economy? According to the classical economists and the neoclassical economists like Adam Smith and Marshall, is that because demand supply, they will take care of themselves. Market will take care of itself. Market prices itself will be a self-controlling mechanism. Very good. But are the market prices here, due to the presence of externalities, are they really reflecting the actual costs? No, they are not, because they are excluding the externalities. Because the externalities are not reflected in market price. That means what? In other words, we can say the market prices are distorted. When the prices themselves are distorted, automatically the entire market is distorted, because market runs on the price mechanism and the price mechanism is ignoring externalities. So that creates market failure and that creates market inefficiencies. That is the first point. Second thing, other things like as we just now discussed, the negative externalities impose costs on the society. They cause costs on the society that extend beyond the cost of production as originally intended by the producer. Naturally, original cost was supposed to be lesser, which was the private cost of the producer. But the real cost on society is much higher. So the negative externalities impose costs on the society, which is higher than beyond the cost of production as contemplated or intended originally by the producer. That is one more point to note. These are facts. This will happen, particularly when the production process is there. Negative externalities do happen, and that is a reality. So what to do? Without government intervention, no producer will have any reason to consider the social costs of pollution. So will he include in his cost, will this sugar factory manufacturer include the social costs also in the pricing of sugar? Will he add this external cost also here somehow and make this sugar more costly so that it is less demanded? No, he will not do that. Why should he do that? Because it is not his cost, na. We are not saying that he is doing wrong, but he will not do that. He is not supposed to do that. He will not do that. That is not his cost. That is external cost. He is not bearing it. He will only price the sugar only according to his private costs. He will ignore the external costs. Naturally, no producer will have any reason to consider the social cost of the pollution, what they are causing. So naturally, because of that, what happens? The firms do not have to worry about the negative externalities. The result is what? Excess production. That's what I was talking about. Excess production happens, overproduction happens, because nobody cares. And naturally, that will cause unnecessary and high social costs. Simple example can be understood with the same sugar factory real life example. We can understand what is social cost and how these externalities can lead to market failure. Because of no possible way of including the external costs into the price mechanism, the producers will tend to produce more than they are supposed to. That results in excess production and that results in unnecessary social costs. And this is all market failure. Market failure is inefficient market, simply. Market failure does not mean suddenly market is off and entire thing is zero. No, failure is not in that sense. Failure means inefficiency in the market is caused by what? One of the reasons in that inefficiencies is externalities. Because the price mechanism, which is the fundamental principle of market economy, is distorted since external costs are not accounted for. They are not included in the price that is normally charged by the producers, since they don't care about what costs others are incurring. And what is going to happen because of that is price distortion and excess production, unnecessary social costs, and all of them put together will create market inefficiency and market failure. That is about externalities in a nutshell. This can be understood with a graph also. You don't need to actually draw this and all, but just understand how negative externalities might create a problem to the society. Of course, the marginal social benefit is same. Let us call this as, let us say, the demand line. Demand curve, it is demand and supply. Market is all about demand curve and supply curve, right? So demand curve is marginal social benefit, which is the same from one particular product. People are consuming sugar. Okay, the benefit whatever they are getting from that is same. But what is the marginal private cost? That is this much only. That is this line, which is indicating marginal private cost. And as we observed already, the marginal social cost is higher than the marginal private cost. And why is that? Because of the external cost. So this is the external cost, we can say. That means marginal social cost is higher than marginal private cost. Forget about social cost, because normally we don't care about social cost. We are only looking at it from theoretical perspective. Normally, what is the price that is charged by the market? That is this price. Because price is nothing but where demand and supply curves are intersecting with each other, isn't it? So where the demand and supply curves are intersecting with each other, normally here. That is a normal demand curve and supply curve intersecting at this point, right? What is the price charged P1? What is the quantity produced Q1? So point is here to note, low price is charged, high quantity is produced at this point normally. That's what happens, which is a problem. But ideally, imagine if social costs are considered also. If external costs are also added to the private cost, and imagine if the social costs are also included, then the price would have been higher. It would have been this, let us say, we call it P2. So this much price should have been actually charged. Because now, this new supply curve is cutting the demand curve at this point. So if you call this, let us say, A point, if this is B, at point A, price was lower, quantity was higher. At point B, price is higher, quantity is lower. So ideally, that is the actual production that should have happened, even if you take sugar as an example, or for that matter anything as an example. So quantity produced should have been low, price should have been high. Since they are not worried about these external costs, since they don't care about the social cost, since they only care about the private cost, they are producing higher quantity in the form of Q1 by charging a lower price at P1. Because of this, what is happening? This is the welfare loss to the society. So this is what is the loss to the society, we can say. The shaded region is the welfare loss. Can we measure it really? Can we quantify it really? Impossible. Very difficult. Almost impossible. But is it there? Should we recognize it? At least as an existence, though we cannot quantify? Yes. That is the welfare loss because of externalities, particularly negative externalities. So negative externalities, loss, they create loss of social welfare. That is the conclusion we can draw from that graph. But still, in spite of that, nobody cares about externalities. Nobody takes them seriously. Why is that? Why are they not taken seriously? One of the reasons is, first thing first, we don't know. As I told, even I don't know why I was sick. I was thinking that is my nature. My body was like that. I was thinking everybody thinks like that. We don't know why, what was the problem also. We don't know actually. Society does not know precisely who are the producers of harmful externalities. We don't even know. Most of the cases, we don't know who is the initiator of these harmful externalities. That is one problem. Well, that we can say because of lack of awareness and better education, we can say. That is one thing. Second thing is another practical issue. Okay, even if the society knows it, the cause-effect linkages are so unclear that the negative externality cannot be unquestionably traced to its producer. It cannot be. It can be traced, but it cannot be unquestionably traced to its producer. A classic example of this cause and effect linkage can be taken not from Indian context, because in India anyway we don't care much about this. In countries like America, where consumer laws are stringent, there were classic cases earlier, few decades back, where some consumers who have smoked cigarettes of Marlboro, for example, had filed cases against that company because after they got cancer, they came to know they got cancer because of smoking cigarettes, and who produced those cigarettes was Marlboro, let us say. And they filed a case against that company, and they got millions of dollars of compensation because they were able to establish the cause and effect linkage. They could get that in that country. Of course, if everybody keeps on filing cases against tobacco manufacturers, then they better stop the production. That is why what they started doing later on the box itself, they started writing, tobacco causes cancer, you will die. You will die, you will die, like that. They keep on threatening the people who are consuming it, so that the same person who has consumed later on cannot say, I don't know, I thought it was fashionable, but suddenly I got cancer. Earlier people used to say this. So the point is, cause and effect linkages are difficult to be established in normal circumstances. In our case also, in my case also, can I sue that sugar factory saying that my entire childhood, those people have actually spoiled. I was not able to play properly all the times where I would have been playing much better than what was my performance. And I was most of the times sick. That could have created problem to my childhood. Yes, some problem would have been created. Can I sue that sugar factory? Of course, from the Indian legal system point of view, it is just a joke. Nobody can actually win that case. But even if you say, let us say, a proper a trial is there, still it is impossible and almost impossible to create that cause and effect linkage. I may sue that, but they will ask one question. Okay, sir, we are very sorry that your lungs were affected badly, but what is the guarantee that it happened because of only our pollution? Can you prove that? How can I prove that? Nobody can prove that. Nobody can prove that. That is the problem. So the cause and effect linkages are very unclear. In reality, even though we know that it is a problem, we cannot actually solve it. Since this linkage of cause and effect is very unclear, and the negative externality cannot be unquestionably traced to its producer, it is difficult. that such a negative externality is the reason for my problem is something that very rarely can be proved. That is a issue with these externalities. So mostly what people do, mostly what the societies do, we just go on. We know that there is a problem. Chalo bhai chalta. It's okay. What to do? Problems are there. Somebody is causing negative externality. We know that. We just ignore it. We just don't take it seriously. Since we are not in a position to understand, first of all, it is a negative externality. And even if we understand it is a negative externality, we don't have the capacity to establish the relationship between the externality itself and the problem that we are facing. So that is the issue with externalities, and that is why, unfortunately, they are not taken very seriously. Of course, not possible to be ignoring them completely in many countries, at least where the governments have, government includes the judiciary. Government don't think only the elected government only. That is one part of it. Government has all the kinds of wings with that. It has legislative, it has executive, it has judiciary. All the three are there, part of it. And in any country, also these problems of not taking externality seriously will exist. But at least judiciary in some countries will have its own role to play, where people can get some recourse, some kind of, we can say, relief that they can get because of their ability to establish that cause and effect relationship. In other countries, it is difficult to establish that cause and effect relationship. That is a problem with externalities, and that is the reality of markets. That is the one of the reasons for market failures. Why is that? We already observed why externalities lead to market failure, because the prices in the market are not reflecting the social costs. They're only reflecting the private costs. That means price distortion is there. Lower prices are charged. Excessive production is happening. Welfare loss is happening. Excessive social costs are happening. But still, in spite of knowing all this, we can only just theoretically say all these things. Practically, can we quantify that welfare loss? Difficult. Difficult and almost impossible. That is the problem with externalities. But they do exist, and they do lead to market failure if government does not at least intervene into these externalities, particularly the negative externalities. Positive externalities, if they are happening, why should we intervene? If somebody is doing good thing, should we intervene and stop him? That is not our job. No need to intervene. Let him happen. Let that happen. No problem. But if negative externalities are happening, then definitely government intervention is required. That we should understand. Now, how that intervention will happen, that we will see in the next unit itself. So with that, we can conclude the two aspects of market failure. One is market power, and second one is externalities. And we will discuss about public goods. Very important discussion. That's a long discussion. So we will discuss about public goods and different types of public goods and private goods, particularly the markets do not produce public goods in abundance, and how these public goods, rather we can say the lack of interest from the market to produce public goods, will lead to market failure. Those things all we'll discuss in the next session. And incomplete information is not a big thing. That is a small thing. We can easily understand that. But public goods is a very big discussion. So market power is one thing, small thing. That is one of the aspects that we discussed today. And externalities is a very important thing, very detailed thing. That is one more crucial aspect we discussed today. Public goods is a very huge discussion, and that we will do in the next session. Incomplete information also we will discuss in the next session. That is not going to be as longer as public goods discussion, but in any case, we'll continue this unit 2 of chapter 2 in the next session, and later in the unit 3 of the same chapter we will understand the remedy for all these problems. We are now only looking at the diagnosis part of the market failure. Why it happens, how it happens is what we are looking at now. Later in unit 3 we will look at the solution. Of course, that has to come from government only. That is the topic of unit 3. But prior to that, we will have to conclude this unit 2 of chapter 2, which will happen in the next session. Till then, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.